In the early 1960s, many thousands of children in many countries all over the world were born with absent or deformed arms and legs, a condition known as phocomelia. Their internal organs were often malformed with gastrointestinal anomalies so severe that many would go on to die in their first weeks of life. The ones who did not die were all too often abandoned by their horrified and bewildered parents, and would eventually go on to lead lives riddled with tremendous difficulties. The culprit was a promising new wonder drug, thalidomide, developed and first introduced into the German market in October 1957 by the Grunenthal pharmaceutical company. Thalidomide was developed in the early 1950s by Heinrich Muchter, a Nazi doctor who had performed experiments on prisoners in concentration camps in Poland during the Second World War. Muchter escaped trial at the end of the war by fleeing to Germany, eventually becoming Grunenthal's head of research in 1946. By the late 1950s, Grunenthal was aggressively marketing thalidomide as the safer alternative to barbiturates. Thalidomide was positioned as a sleep aid and sedative that was readily available over the counter to anyone who asked for it, without a doctor's prescription. By 1960, thalidomide was used to treat all things from coughs to colds and even headaches. Thalidomide became an overnight commercial success, making Heinrich Muchter and Grunenthal lavishly wealthy, as its sales quickly began rivaling those of aspirin in the 46 countries it was available and distributed in. But upon finding that their wonder drug also had anti-emetic properties, meaning that it was effective against vomiting and nausea, Grunenthal seized the opportunity and quickly began promoting thalidomide to pregnant women as an effective and safe treatment for morning sickness. But it proved to be anything but. The first baby affected by thalidomide was born in December 1956 to an employee of the Grunenthal Pharmaceutical Company. Thalidomide was eventually banned in most countries in 1962. After the number of cases of babies suffering from a range of severe deformities grew exponentially, and it became difficult, rather impossible, to ignore the effect thalidomide had on the babies of pregnant mothers. It took 5 long years and countless lives for the connection between thalidomide and miscarriages and congenital deformities to become apparent. It would take more than 50 years for Grunenthal to accept responsibility for the thalidomide disaster, finally offering an apology to the survivors of this tragedy. My name is Hashem Mashher and I'm a University of Cambridge graduate and student doctor, and this is Doctor Tell Me Why, my YouTube channel where I get to talk about anything I want, so long as it's medicine or health related. And today I'll be telling you about the worst man-made disaster in the history of medicine, explaining why it happened and why it was allowed to continue for as long as it did, and how in the wake of that scandal, it gave way to greater oversight over pharmaceutical companies and drugs, and changed our relationship with Big Pharma forever. So if at any point you find yourself enjoying this video, please take the time to subscribe. If you do, you'll be amply rewarded with great medical and scientific content each and every week. It's important to recognize that our understanding of medicine has come a long way since the 1950s. In the 1950s, scientists, pharmaceutical companies, and the public were, for the most part, unaware that a drug could pass through the placenta from an expecting mother onto her child. Thus, thalidomide was actively promoted to millions of pregnant women as an effective and safe treatment for morning sickness, without ever having been tested on pregnant women. Thalidomide was deemed to be safe largely because of studies the Grunenthal company performed on mice. Research scientists found that unlike with barbiturates, it was virtually impossible to give the mice too much, a lethal dose of thalidomide. It was also later discovered that mice were actually largely insensitive to thalidomide and therefore did not show many of the side effects and congenital anomalies that would be later observed in the children of pregnant mothers. The thalidomide disaster was the first time that scientists actually realized that different species could respond to the same drug in entirely different ways. It was also difficult to recognize babies affected by the thalidomide disaster as one group of children suffering from the same condition. This was because many showed a wide range of congenital defects, as thalidomide appeared to affect everything from the limbs to the face to the eyes, ears, genitalia, heart, kidneys, and other internal organs. Initially, doctors believed that these defects were the result of genetic abnormalities or nuclear fallout. The exact congenital defect acquired depended largely on when the drug was consumed during a 16-day time-sensitive window during the pregnancy, which coincided with morning sickness. We now know, however, that a single 50 mg tablet of thalidomide is sufficient to cause birth defects in up to 50% of pregnancies if taken within that time-sensitive window. And while scientists and doctors began suspecting a link between thalidomide and birth defects in 1958, these suspicions were quickly brushed off and suppressed by the Grunenthal Pharmaceutical Company. It was only in 1961 when a German pediatrician, Dr. Wilkund Lenz, published a series of scientific studies proving that thalidomide did indeed cause birth defects that governments around the world began responding, and thalidomide was eventually banned in 1962. We now believe that thalidomide causes these birth defects by preventing angiogenesis in the fetus, a process whereby new blood vessels emerge from pre-existing ones. Using chicken embryos as an animal model, scientists observed that blood vessels were destroyed within 1 hour when exposed to thalidomide. Blood vessels are essential for healthy embryonic development, supplying both oxygen and nutrients to the rapidly growing fetus, and undermining that blood supply has the potential to lead to developmental defects. In 1968, the Grunenthal Pharmaceutical Company was brought to trial for its role in the thalidomide disaster. In the end, however, no one was found guilty of any misconduct. But the thalidomide scandal came with a silver lining. The thalidomide scandal forced governments around the world to review how drugs were tested, licensed, and regulated. Before 1963, drug companies in the United States only had to show that their drug was safe. The 1963 Kefauver Harris Amendment, however, required drug companies to show that their drug was both safe and effective through the use of both animal and human trials. Drugs could no longer be approved purely on the basis of animal testing, and drugs that were intended for use by pregnant women had to be tested on pregnant women and proven to be safe for pregnant women. Drug companies were also for the first time required to follow up individuals who took a new drug and survey them for side effects, and were now required to accurately disclose those side effects to consumers and report them back to the FDA. Believe it or not, prior to 1963, drug companies were not required by law to disclose accurate information regarding a drug's side effects to patients. In the UK, the 1968 Medicines Act made distinctions for the first time between drugs that were available directly over the counter to consumers and drugs that were only available via a doctor's prescription. You could say that for the first time, this brought this idea into the mainstream that drugs weren't completely harmless, and that doctors had to assess the benefits and risks of a certain drug before prescribing it to their patient. Today, the FDA approves thalidomide for use in two situations: in the treatment of inflammation associated with Hansen's disease, commonly known as leprosy, and as a chemotherapeutic agent in the treatment of multiple myeloma. I'm afraid that's it for today. Thank you guys for making it to the end with me. If you enjoyed this video, then please give this video a thumbs up so that YouTube can begin recommending this video to more people. And if you really love this video, then please subscribe for more great quality content just like this. If you subscribe, I promise to tell you about all these fascinating medical conditions, present you the latest groundbreaking medical research, and give you top tips on living a healthier life and being the best version of you out there. Love you all to bits, and see you all next Saturday.